In Luke's gospel, after an unsuccessful night of fishing, Jesus tells his disciples to put out into the deep. The passage ends with a haul of fish that nearly sinks the boats. After that, Simon Peter, James, and John leaving their work behind to become committed followers of Jesus. Aptly, this story illustrates the call that men receive to the priesthood. Men like today's guest, Father Gerard Gentleman, the pastor at Holy Family Parish in Hicksville, and he will share with us his path to the vocation as a priest here on It's a Wonderful Life. Welcome back to It's a Wonderful Life. We're joined today by Father Gerard Gentleman, the pastor of Holy Family Parish in Hicksville. And I have been so blessed to kind of walk in his footsteps. I followed him at St. Killian's in Farmingdale, at Holy Trinity, and now he is like the central of vocations at Holy Family. Father Gerard, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, Father Joe. Good, glad to be here.
Father Gerard, tell us a little bit about your faith and family experience growing up that affected your priesthood.
Sure. Well, I'm the oldest of five, and my mom tells a story that I grew up in St. Joe's in Ronkonkoma, and she remembers being at somebody's first Mass, and she never said anything to me about it, but she thought in her mind, this would be really nice to have a son who's a priest. And but we never really talked much about it. I mean, we were active in the parish. I think we got to know some of the priests pretty well. So it was on my mind. But, you know, we were, I think, a typical Catholic family. Went to Mass on Sunday. We were altar servers. Involved somewhat in various different parish activities, but more just really part of the community. And it was, I think it was very much always a part of my life. I mean, I remember my mom, this was the earlier days after, you know, when I was the first child, we'd pray the rosary in the car sometimes, or along with my next door neighbor had a particular devotion to the Blessed Mother. You know, those kind of influences were there growing up. But I always say to people, it was never anything extraordinary, nothing ever, you know, I went to public school, went to religious ed. I would say that I was fortunate to have two school sisters of Notre Dame as my catechists. And I think that I got a little extra bonus there in having those seeds planted for me. But, you know, that was really the life growing up. And I think it was just my own personal faith. And, the question of priesthood, I don't know why it was there, but it was always there. And I kept thinking I'd eventually get to it, you know, and through high school, through college. And it really wasn't until the end of college and I had started working a little bit that I said, I got to get rid of this question. But, you know, my family had developed some other relationships with priests, and they were great to talk to as well, too. But, you know, I think in all the different things that went on in life in high school and even in college, that just going getting to Mass on Sunday and some personal prayer was always a part of my life. And, you know, I know that came to me from my family, I'm sure.
So college, Catholic college?
Nope, State College, SUNY Fredonia, majored in theater. You know, that, and sometimes, you know, I when I would think about priests, I'd say, well, I'm on this path. How could I possibly think about this other path? But I think there's two things I took from that experience. Certainly, we're very public people as sure. priests and comfortable being public, being, and also knowing, having a sense of, you know, the liturgy really started as theater, or I should say theater really started as liturgy, you know, that, so having that sense of that, you know, certainly has been a part of me. But also I think one of the things about the, you know, the world of theater or in the arts is that there's always a desire to know something and know how someone, and why someone acts and what they do and what they, you know, and so when you're preparing a play or whatever it might be and you're studying a character, you're not doing it from the outside, judging someone, trying to get to know who they are there at their core. So I think that's very much a part of, you know, who I am. But, you know, after I graduated college and I had a few little jobs here and there in New York, I was fortunate to do that, never performing, but, you know, a couple of things. And I just realized I wasn't happy, you know, and so this is not what I see myself doing. And I found myself going, because I was working in New York, I would go to St. Patrick's Cathedral, I'd go to Our Lady's Chapel in the back, and it was just such a place of solitude. I could hear the traffic and everything outside, but I'd be in there, and I just, you know, I kept asking the question, and that was Lent of that year, of being out of college that year. I just actively began to think about it, you know, more and more, but, and helped me to realize that you know, this was a continuation of the path that I was on. And finally had the courage to talk to a couple of priests. And you would have envied the interview with me because I was in and out of the vocation director's office. One visit, had the application in hand. So it was great.
Well, you talked a little bit about just kind of journeying with a couple of priests, speaking to them. Can you speak into, like, your first assignment? Mm-hmm. So you come out of the seminary, you go to your first assignment. How important is that first pastor?
It's extremely important, you know, to feel like you fit there. And I remember being extremely nervous, as, you know, as we do, you know, all the guessing games are going on, who it's going to be, the parish that we're going to go to. And I knew a little bit about St. Killian's. One of my classmates had gone there, but not much. But I was relieved from what I heard. And, you know, they were a parish that, as you know, they're really good at accepting newly ordained priests, and so it was a great environment to be in, and a good house as far as priests to live with. I was living with Bishop Dunn at the time. My pastors, Monsignor Swiger, who God rest him, was, you know, such a legend in the diocese, as well as spending a little bit of time with us in between pastoral assignments. Another great priest of our diocese, Monsignor John Martin, and he was so helpful to me. To, you know, pastors are busy, and to be able to just sit with John a lot and get his counsel as well as his humor that, you know, helped to kind of put it all in perspective. But the people of the parish were extremely welcoming and loving. I mean, I remember when I was still in the seminary hearing a priest speaking at his first mass about how he loved the church. Mm. And I didn't understand what that meant. And I don't think I really understood it until that first assignment, and really fell in love with being a priest, fell in love with the people of the parish. It was just a wonderful experience to be there. And my pastor gave me a tremendous amount of freedom. Unfortunately, he was sick, so he depended upon me a lot. It was a wonderful environment to grow and figure out what kind of a priest I was, what are the things that I was interested in.
So here you are, you're newly ordained, you're in the first love of your life as a priest. You have a great mentoring system there between Monsignor John and Bishop, and also, of course, Charlie, who passed. And then they take you out of it.
All right.
You go into special ministry. So most people think of the day-to-day of, it's confessions, it's mass, it's weddings. Well, now all of a sudden, you're taken out of that and you go to the high school. Right. How was that experience for you?
You know, when we know the newly ordained priests, the way it works for us, in 5 years, you're going to go on to another assignment. And I was just so bothered by that. I was like, how do I go and fall in love with another parish? How do I go and do the same thing somewhere else? And the opportunity came to go to Holy Trinity. They were looking for a chaplain. And I had worked with the youth group. I didn't consider myself like a teenage kind of working guy and everything else. But for whatever reason, I felt called to say, maybe that's something different, so I don't have to go to another parish. And it was, in some ways it was a relief, but that, you know, it also involved kind of learning differently what it meant to be a priest. As you know from being there, I said to people all the time, you know, the parish, you get to know the whole family a little bit more. You know, you see them grow up, and people are choosing to be with you in the life of the parish. At school, at Holy Trinity, it's a workplace for everybody, for the teachers, for the students, and so it's a whole different approach to things. Also realizing, too, that for many, it is their primary faith experience, too. So those are the kind of things I had to learn differently. You know, how do we approach high school as parish life in some way, realizing that there's a whole different dynamic going on here, that this is not the primary reason that people are in this building. They're here in the context of education.
Well, so. Also for you, too. I mean, obviously, Holy Trinity is well known for its academics and its athletics, but the arts as well.
And I don't know if I knew that much about that when I was applying there. I knew that they had done a few things, but that was, you know, a great place to, I think when you're doing high school work, as you know, you find a place where there's some commonality, where something that you know that is beyond just the sacramental role of the priest. So, yes, the theater program was great. I actually wound up directing two shows. I know you coached some football. I directed some plays. But having those opportunities to be some, just for kids to see you differently and for you to see them, you know, differently as well.
So then again, transition time. Mm-hmm. You come out of the parish, you come out of the school into a parish, and now you're a pastor.
Right.
What's the difference between being a pastor, being a chaplain, or just, you know, a day-to-day priest?
There's another whole level of responsibility. I mean, there's a part of it that, you know, when you are someone's associate pastor, when you're the chaplain at a high school, you're working with within the system. Somebody else, it's you're trying to work with someone else's whole vision. As the pastor, it's yours, you know, in a sense, not, you know, that it's mine and all my ideas, but, you know, I'm the leader with it, and I have to make those decisions. And it's exciting to have those and say, what would I like to create? What do I want to see here? But also everything is on you, all the responsibilities of life, you know, everything from, you know, maintenance issues to, you know, employee salaries, all that kind of stuff. And you got to try to incorporate that all in. I remember having a conversation with my dad shortly after I was a pastor, and he said, you know, what about all this, you know, this stuff? All the, you know, that's not why you were ordained, to worry about all those things. And I said, yeah, but Dad, you didn't get married and, you know, decide to have kids so you could get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. My dad was, you know, involved in construction. That's not why you got married, but you had to do those things to care for our family. They call me father. So I've been able to, you know, think about different influences. I think my dad's role as father, you know, helps me to understand what my role is as pastor. But it's, you know, almost 8 years now, and it takes a long time to really have a balance in that, and you know, because it's so easy to get involved in the, you know, the management of things and lose the contact, everyday contact with people.
And Holy Family has a school as well, right?
So we do.
Was that helpful that you had a little bit of time at Holy
Family?
It was
Trinity? Helpful, you know, and a little shocking at first, you know, when you go from, you know, high school kids where most of the kids were taller than me and at high school to, you know, to go to an elementary school where we start with nursery. So we got babies, we have 3-year-olds, you know, and so it's a whole different way, and learning how to talk to them differently. I thought I didn't know how to talk to high school students when I got to high school. Now, you know, how do you talk to little ones? And, you know, but it's, I tell you, you know, having a school is such a blessing to a parish. Certainly there are challenges to maintaining a school, but the life that it brings, you know, to a parish. And it's, you know, and it's a ministry beyond the parish as well, too. We have over 30 parishes represented at our parish school. So we realize we're doing a ministry of the diocese as well, too. We're providing Catholic education beyond just our own parish boundaries. So that's a perspective that I didn't necessarily have when I went in and realized, you know, that this is what we do. You know, this is part of our mission to the larger church. We do Catholic education.
You know, one of the great gifts that you have, too, as well, is balancing leadership, fatherhood as a priest, pastor. You also have, you've become like a vocations magnet out of Holy Family. And you spoke about speaking to high school kids, speaking to young people. I'm going to ask you to just take maybe about 25, 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. What would you say to parents who are discerning? Okay, so you have five young people, mm-hmm. a sister, and then 4 young men discerning the priesthood or religious life. So there's something happening at Holy Family. Mm-hmm. What would you say to the parents who might have a son or daughter that's discerning to help them?
You know, parents want the best for their kids, and I think the bottom line is they're sometimes afraid of what, you know, of the choices that, you know, their kids are making, and ultimately, do they want to be happy? You know, are they going to be happy with what they're doing? And you know, that's what my parents' concerns were. You know, when I first went to college, I wasn't a theater major. I was communications or something. And I had my parents talk to the theater teacher there. And that was their primary question, you know, will he be happy doing this? And the same thing, you know, with, you know, going to beginning of the seminary and, you know, will you be happy? And I think that's the first thing I'd want to say to parents, that, you know, you have to not be afraid that any course in life that is going to help your child to be happy is the best thing, and they can be happy. And I think that's, you know, sometimes what the fear is, and also that you look at everybody else, their peers. Decision making is a process. You know, it's not something they're going to do. They're just making a decision to take one step, and I think that sometimes is the easiest thing for parents to understand and hear, because they have to grow into that as well, too. So it's just about taking a step. That's it.
And there you have it. Like, you know, the life and journey of faith is about taking a step. And certainly, as Father Gerard responded to the priesthood, we know that when he did, his life was transformed forever, and he embraced the life of the priesthood, which is a wonderful life. Thanks for being with us today. As Catholics responding to the challenge of Bishop Barris to encourage dramatic missionary growth in the diocese, we use all forms of promoting the gospel, including television and social media. If you want to know any more about any of the priests we featured here or have any questions or comments, you can email us at itsawonderfullife@telecaretv.org. Or you can tweet us at RVC Vocations. We may even put up your comments during our show. You can also visit our website at longislandpriest.com. See you next time right here on It's a Wonderful Life.